just yammering on about Viking sales. It's kind of neat stuff, but we're at 3:16, so let's go ahead and get started. So welcome. How's everyone doing today? Good. So how many people were here yesterday? It should probably be most of you. I shouldn't raise my hand because I wasn't here yesterday. I'm glad you're here for the second day. I actually got here early thinking, I got here late thinking I was going to be late, but I was actually early because I didn't know that we didn't do the conference for the first half of the day. And so I got here at about 11 o'clock, and I'm like, oh, I'm right on time. So it's good. You know, I could sleep in and give a talk. That never happens. So this is deep learning like a Viking, building convolutional neural networks with Keras. Anyone recognize this guy? Techno Viking, yeah. Go Google it. It was like one of those real early viral videos that came out around 2000. Great stuff. I just thought this picture looked cool, so I used it as a cover. My name is Guy Royse. I'm an engineering manager at ScriptDrop. I don't know what it says on the program. It probably says I'm a developer evangelist with DataRobot. But I just left that job about 2 weeks ago, and so some of the stuff's not updated yet. But I work at ScriptDrop here in town. And I've been writing software for about 25 years, and that's my background. I'm a software developer. I'm not a data scientist or anything like that. I'm a software guy. Pun not intended. if you want to check, follow me on Twitter and try and annoy me with tweets while I'm talking, you can follow me at Guy Royse. You won't be able to annoy me because my phone is in airplane mode. And then I've got a website at guy.dev where you can see my outdated blog. And you can go to code.guy.dev, it'll take you to my GitHub repos, including the code for this particular talk. Like I said, I've been writing software for a long time. I've done a lot of different languages. I've done a lot of Java, a lot of C++, a lot of JavaScript, a lot of Ruby, a little bit of Python. I'm not really a seasoned Python pro. I haven't been paid to write production Python code. So if you see my Python and say, there's a better way to do that, you're probably right. But I did get Keras to do things and build a neural network, and so we're going to show that today. Another interesting thing about me, something that I think is really important to understand, is this. Anyone have an idea what that stands for? I am not a data scientist. I'm a fan of data science, and I've been spending the last 2 years learning about it and how to use these tools to make them do things, but I'm not a deep, dyed-in-the-wool data scientist. I've got a programming background. I'm actually not even particularly mathy. Just through idiosyncrasies of my educational career, I never got beyond basic trigonometry, which, incidentally, I've never used for anything other than carpentry. So I don't have a math background. My math teacher actually called me average. I thought that was mean. Womp womp. I know that's a terrible joke, so I've got a better one. What's a pirate's favorite programming language? You might think it'd be R, but his first love be the C. I told this joke one time, and this guy responded with Perl. Like, that's a really good answer. So one thing I am, however, is I'm a huge fan of Vikings. I just think Vikings are kind of intrinsically cool, right? I mean, I think a lot of people think that. You know, you got imagine this big red-headed guy with the helmet with the horns on it coming off a ship and just taking what he wants, right? They're kind of metal, right? And they're kind of cool. And I've always been fascinated with Vikings. And I did the 23andMe, and so I thought I'd see what my heritage was. And it turns out that I'm actually Viking myself. This explains my fascination with them. I like that I'm 4% uncertain and 2% Scandinavian. Luck of the draw, I guess, right? What I did out of my love of Vikings is I think their alphabet's cool. This is the Younger Futhark. It's what Vikings used to write stuff down when they wanted to write stuff down. And it's just an alphabet like we have in English. And I've built a convolutional neural network that can recognize these symbols and tell you which one you've drawn. And I'm going to demo it later. But I thought I'd talk a little bit about what the letters were, because some of you may not have heard of runes before, because they're, you know, if you've played Dungeons and Dragons, you know what these things are, right? If you've listened to Led Zeppelin, you've got a good idea what these things are. But they're just an alphabet that the Vikings use. There's 16 characters, and it's called the Futhark because the first six letters spell the word Futhark. That's it. It's just like we have a QWERTY keyboard because it says QWERTY. Here, you've got, on the left here, you've got these runes, Fey, Thurs, Os, Wreath, and Kaun. I think that's how you say those. And they make the F, U, T, H, A, R, and K sounds, respectively. So it spells the word Futhark. Kind of fun. And it's got a reduced symbol set, so there's not the full range of letters we have in English. And so when I transliterated my name into the Futhark, the Younger Futhark, it comes out as Kai Royce, because there's no G, and there's no O. And so this is what you end up with. And I've decided that this is how I'm going to name all of my Dungeons & Dragons characters from now on. I'm just going to take a common name. Well, I guess my name's not common, but take a name, transliterate it into the Younger Futhark, and then back into English, and then all of a sudden it sounds great. I'll look smart. It's like, oh, I'm just, you know, matching letters up. But it's a kind of a neat alphabet. And we know about it because it was on the Lings. Well, this is an example of it. We've got a lot of examples of it where it's been carved into things. This is a Lingsberg runestone, the Lingsberg runestone. It's outside of Stockholm. And look at this thing, right? You've got this big cross up here. I mean, that looks like something on the cover of a Black Sabbath album right there. You've got these beasts in the background. You've got this dragon here, this double-headed, these two dragons. And they got these magical symbols carved all along their bodies. I mean, it, right? it's just kind of cool looking. It's hard not to like this stuff. And in reality, this is actually a monument to someone's fallen husband named Holmfritter, which is right here. That little D-like thing is called F. Makes the TH sound. So Holmfritter. And he had died, and so his wife and sons erected this monument, which is actually kind of sweet. And if you look at it closely, you can actually see Holmfritter's name in here. It's right here, and you can see right there, there's the, well, I don't need to highlight it, but there's that first rune there is Hagel, makes the H sound. U, that makes the U sound, so there it's Hum. L, and then you can see all the runes in there. And so there's actual, I mean, this is real. This is not just a, you know, the rest of it's written in Old Norse, but I can read his name. so yeah, this is how we know a lot about this kind of stuff. In fact, you have runes on your phone. This is actually true. the Bluetooth protocol was named after Harald Bluetooth, who was a Danish king that brought a bunch of Danish tribes, united them together. And they were using it as a code name for the project because they were bringing computers and peripherals together. So that was the idea. And they were gonna come up with some other brand and nothing stuck, and they just decided to keep calling it Bluetooth. And so they took the runes. This is Hagel right here, makes the H sound. This is pretty obviously makes the B sound, right? It looks like a B. Bjork, which makes the B sound, and they just laid them on top of each other, creating a bind rune of those two letters. And that's the Bluetooth logo. So kind of fun. And looking at these letters, you might think, you know, these look a lot like Latin and Greek letters that I've seen before. Like look at, I mentioned it, Bjork looks a lot like B and beta. Tyr looks a lot like tau and T. You can see over here, Fe kind of looks a lot like F. Thurs kind of looks like a theta, or you can see how a theta might have turned into it over time. Rho and R. Isa hasn't changed at all on any of them. Sigma, right there, sigma and S and sol, they're all crooked lines, right? That's basically what an S is. And this is actually for a reason, and that's because they have a common ancestor. So the Younger Futhark and came from the Elder Futhark. Modern Latin came from Latin. And they both got their alphabet, it's believed, from Etruscan, or one of the other Italic alphabets. Latin definitely came from Etruscan, but they're not sure about the runes. And so they have a common, they have common ancestry. And so a lot of the symbols are the same. And if you look here, ancient Greek is where Etruscan came from. And interestingly enough, it goes all the way back to hieroglyphics. And so the hieroglyphics were adopted by Semitic tribes and simplified to make consonants. The Greeks took those from the Phoenicians, who were also the Canaanites, and added vowels, and then the Etruscans got them, and then we got them, and it's really kind of interesting. The Younger Futhark is actually led to another alphabet called the Anglo-Saxon Futhark, which was used to write Old English before the Latin alphabet took over. And so English actually has a letter called thorn, which makes a TH sound, which looks just like the TH thurs in Futhark. So, and I know what you're all thinking, this is neat, but what does this have to do with programming? I just thought it was cool. That's all I got. So we're going to use these this alphabet. We're going to try and build software to recognize runes. And we're going to use neural networks to do it. And I thought the best way to understand the neural network initially would be to understand how the neuron, how the individual piece works. Then we can see how they work in concert. So a neuron is kind of like a logic gate in a very broad sense. Like here we have an AND gate, and it's got three inputs and an output. And if we put actual numbers into that AND gate, it'll do what an AND gate does. It'll take, they're not all one, so it's zero in this scenario. But the inside of an AND gate is really easy to understand because it's just, there's a very simple rule that defines what they do. A neuron in a neural network also has these inputs and it has an output. But instead of taking ones and zeros, trues and falses, 5 volts or 0 volts, they take actual floating point numbers. And so in this case, you got, like, say, these numbers on the left that I picked more or less at random, and you've got an output on the right, which is another number. And so the way that this is computing this is not as transparent as an AND gate would be. And so to understand that, we have to look inside and see what are the pieces, parts that's happening. And so this is the inside of a neuron, and it's outside. And when I say inside and outside, when you're using something like TensorFlow, it's not really a concept. but conceptually, it's easier to think about it as having an inside and outside, just because these are the things that happen. So I know that's saying it's an inside of the neuron is a slight misrepresentation of what's happening, but it's close enough for what we're doing here today. So we got our inputs. Those are just the floating point numbers coming into this neuron. And we've got the weights. And I like to think of the weights as making the input more or less important. So this neuron's going to get inputs from a lot of other neurons, and some of them may be important for it and some might not be. And so the weight is just multiplied times the input, so x times w. And then you sum them all up. So now you've got a number. There's also a bias, which sort of shoves this neuron's importance up by being added. It's just a number that's added to that summation. I've been told, and I'm like I said, I don't have a strong math background, but part of the objective of having a bias is to keep it from running through origin every single time so that it does something. let's look at the math so far here. So here we've got x times w plus x2 times w2 plus the bias. So this is just arithmetic. What's happening inside these neurons. They're not particularly magical. You could write that even mathier with a sigma there. But this is about the extent of my advanced mathematics here, is to use sigma to show summation. But this is what's happening here. It's the sum of the x's times the w's, the inputs times the weights, plus the bias. You might be wondering at this point, well, how do we set the w's and the b's? How do we set the weights and the biases? And, well, my short answer is that you call model.fit. My long answer is that you use backpropagation and stochastic gradient descent. However, those are just words that I know how to say. I don't actually know what they mean. I have an idea of what they mean, but I don't have the math background to really understand that fully. But again, I make the joke about calling model.fit, but actually, as developers, that's often enough. We can make this thing do things without having to know the math. The math can be buried in the algorithm. If you've ever used scikit-learn, and let's say you're going to do, even just like a basic linear regression, you can just say, do a linear regression, and here's my numbers, and it does it. You don't have to look at the formula for it. It's encoded inside the library. And so we can do a similar thing with neural networks. Once we have an output, there's an activation function. Or once we have all this added together, there's an activation function. And I have sort of lamely said down here that that adjusts the output of the neuron, because I couldn't think of anything else to say. but it does modify it. And there's several different activation functions we can use. There's the step function. And this was the one that was used initially when neural networks were being played with. If it's 0 or less, it's 0. Otherwise, it's 1. Is it activated or not? And so this is a pretty simple problem, or pretty simple function to be used to adjust the output of that neuron. It basically says fired, not fired. And that can work, but it didn't work really well, because you would be slowly adjusting the weights and biases to get it where you want, and it would abruptly change behavior. So it was not firing, not firing, not firing, and then all of a sudden it would fire. And so you couldn't adjust it more smoothly. And so it didn't work as well. So a lot of people switched to a sigmoid function, which allowed you to, instead abruptly switching from 0 to 1, abruptly from not fired to fired, it allowed it to smoothly go that way. And so you could approach 1 and approach 0. And that worked a little better, but it also meant that your weights kept getting significantly larger to accommodate the idea that I want to be closer to 1. Because, you know, you're chasing that value. It's like halfway there, halfway there, halfway there, and you never get there. And so your values in your network got kind of wonky. This is my layman's version of how I think this works. So there's probably a data scientist in here right now that's saying, no, that's completely wrong. It's like, oh, okay. I'd be happy to learn more. Again, I'm studying this, learning it, trying to figure out how it works. But mostly I call model.fit. You can use a hyperbolic tangent, which is very similar to a sigmoid, just a little bit taller. And that works okay too, but has the same fundamental problem. Some folks tried using linear functions. And the negative numbers are always kind of weird. But that's not really the big problem with a linear function. The problem with a linear function is that if you have any depth in your neural network, if you got any hidden layers, they just collapse down effectively to one, as if you had one layer. And that means certain types of problems can't be solved. So you know, you got your input layer and hidden layers and your output layer. If they all collapse down, like, you can't do exclusive OR effectively that way. And so this doesn't work. And what everyone's kind of settled on is rectified linear units. And this is the easiest function. Well, actually, this is the easiest function because it's x equals x. this one is max x comma 0. So all we're saying is, hey, we don't want negative numbers because they're a little weird, but we want the positive numbers to go as positive as we want them to, so that we can activate a little bit, or we can activate hard, and as we adjust, it activates harder and harder. And so this is what everyone tends to use. There are reasons to use other ones. I'm not really qualified to know why you would use one over the other in those scenarios. I know I use ReLU and it works. A lot of the stuff that I've read about this says things like, well, we're not exactly sure why, so much as we tried it and this works better. That seems to be how a lot of the documents that I've read read. And well, that sounds like a developer to me. But I tried it and it worked better. So I'm going to be using rectified linear units. I actually think ReLU is kind of a really big fancy name for max 0 comma x. It just seems like a lot. They must have been a programmer. So then once you've done all that, you now have an output. That's the value coming out of the neuron. And then that output will go into every neuron in the next layer. And so you end up with this network of these neurons. Here we've got two hidden layers in blue. We've got an input layer in red, output layer in yellow. The input layer probably doesn't have any weights on it, because it's probably just posted at a value. It might have a bias. It might have activation functions. There's lots of ways you can do it, but you know, probably not. The middle layers have the weights and the biases and all that. And so every layer every neuron feeds into every neuron in the next layer. And so this first middle layer would have each one would have three inputs. The next layer, each one would have five inputs. And the output layer, each one would have five inputs. And so they just sort of cascade down and recalculate, and it's a lot of arithmetic happening, but it is just arithmetic. Of course, this type of neural network is called a fully connected neural network, or a dense neural network. But it's actually bad at recognizing runes. And the reason it's bad at doing that is because, let's think about how would we recognize a rune, right? So we got some image, and say it's, hypothetically speaking, 24 pixels by 24 pixels, because that's the size I used in my example. If it's that size, you could take whatever 24 squared is and have that many input neurons. And then just have a bunch of deep layers, or a couple deep layers that are, however big they need to be, and then spit out what rune it is. You could build a neural network to do that. But it's inefficient. The problem is that the neural network would have to learn to recognize that rune in every possible place it could be on the screen. So sometimes you're going to write it and it's going to be a little bit to the left. Or I guess that's your right, isn't it? Yeah. And sometimes that rune's going to be a little bit to the right. And sometimes that rune's going to be short. And sometimes it's going to be tall because it's closer or further away. And the network has to learn that when I see a thing that looks like this on the with this shape on the left and on the right and in the middle and everywhere in between, those are all also that same thing. And so it's just got to store a lot more information. It's kind of like if I was learning how to recognize someone, and if I saw them on the left side of the room, then I would only be able to recognize them as that person there, and a different part of my brain would recognize them if they're on the opposite side of this wall here, if they were on the right side of the room, or if I was far away or close. And so that just doesn't scale up. The amount of neurons you need doesn't work. And so our brains are finite. And so it did efficient things to make that work better. And those efficient things are called convolutional neural networks. And that's based off of, inspired by biology. And so this is a convolutional neural network. So thanks for coming. So I've got several layers here, and this is kind of more of a guide, tying together graphic. It's actually very complicated looking. But this represents the input image, a series of filters that are run over that image, the output mapping of those filters, a pooling layer that concentrates those mappings down to help with overfitting, and then going into a regular neural network and making a classification. That's what this is showing. Don't worry, you don't have to memorize that. I'm going to talk about the convolutions first. So the idea of this convolution is you've got this input image. Here we've got the rune Mather. Makes the M sound. I think it means man, which kind of makes sense, because it looks like a dude with his arms up like this. It's not Y. Y-M-C-A. Yeah. And you've got a series of filters, which the network trains. It finds patterns in it. And so the filter pans and scans across the input image and creates a map of where that filter was matched. And so here we're looking for a straight up and down line. Here we're looking for a plus. Here we're looking for a diagonal and the other diagonal. And we just put in that map where they're found. And you can see this with a fancy animation right here. So we're panning and scanning. We're moving across the image one pixel row at a time. You can actually put padding around here so it'll create default values on the edges in case a rune's shoved right up against the edge. You can see none of these have triggered the filter yet because they don't match perfectly. And so that will trigger it right there. And this triggers it right there. And then the rest of it isn't going to. And so you end up with an output map of, hey, I found this shape in these places on the image. By the way, that animation was incredibly painful to make, so I hope you all enjoyed it. But I feel like it really shows how that convolution is going across it. It's panning and scanning across it just like, that's just what it does. It's looking for matches. Of course, behind the scenes, this is actually using numbers. And so here we've got an input, and I've got one for black and zero for white. And that's because I used the alpha channel on my original demo. And so 255 alpha would be solid black. And then here we've got a filter which has also got numbers in it. And we got this other thing down here that wasn't there before. And I'll give you a little prequel. That's the bias. And then you have your output map, which has got numbers in it as well. And what's happening here is what's happening inside the neuron. So we take the top 3x3 section up here, right? It's all zeros and a one. We multiply the x input times all the weights, which is going to give us a total of minus one, because it's all zeros are going to wipe out. The one times negative one is negative one. We add our bias of negative two, or negative one, to get negative two. And then on the top right, we put in a big fat zero, because ReLU says that's less than zero. So we're using that exact same innards of the neuron. This is the innards of the neuron that's wired differently. It's partially connected. I haven't been able to visualize this in my head yet, because it's hard to visualize n-dimensional things. But this is the sort of the process that's happening. It's that same math. And so you'll notice that this is good for finding things that sort of match. So if we look at the second row down, we got a 3x3 area there. And on the right, that maps to a 1, because the math comes out that it's 1. Because that's really close to our filter, right? It's close to that straight up and down line. The same thing happens down here at the bottom. But other areas where it's further off, it gets below 0, ReLU kicks in, and it becomes 0. So we get this nice map of basically everywhere that shape is found. Once we've done that, we now have this wonderful map. And we can go through the act of pooling. Pooling is a way of saying, look in a particular location, divide this thing up into sections, and take the biggest value, or take whether there's a thing there or not, and create a concentrated map. So if we look here, we're going across this and saying, is there something in this square or not? If there is, mark it out. And what this does is it helps with the neural network from getting overly fixated on, say, like a little jog in a line. You got a line going straight up and down, but it's slightly angled. Like if it's a slight angle like this, when you pull it, it's going to be straight. And so that it keeps the model from fixating on the fact that, well, if the line's at a slight angle, then it means one thing, and otherwise it means another. And again, this is actually just numbers. And so what you're really doing is you're taking the largest number in that 3x3 area, or that 2x2 area, or that 5x5, whatever size you choose when you build your neural. And so you can see, like here we have a 1, and that 1 goes up there. Down here we've got a 2 and a 1, and so that goes, the 2 goes in the bottom. Once we're done with the pooling, we can go through a flattening layer, which is really not a very complicated process. It just says, take these two-dimensional arrays of inputs and turn them into just a big line. And those can go into a fully connected layer, and then it just works like a regular neural network, and we get our classifier working. And so, that's pretty much how convolutional neural networks work. The thing that can happen here is you can go through multiple convolutions. So you can take your image, filters and convolutions. You can do this a couple times. And what will happen over time is you'll get higher order objects. So in the sense of initially it's finding little lines, then it's finding groups of lines in a particular shape. So hey, I've got a line here, a line here, and a line here. And then the next layer says, hey, I found these lines in these positions. That's a triangle. And then you can put another layer that says, these are two triangles together with a curve. That's the top of a cat, right? That kind of stuff. And so it builds this hierarchical model. And it all happens as part of the training of the neural network. So you don't have to pick these filters in advance. It's just, it figures them out. So how do we build this stuff? I'm glad you asked. I'm going to use Keras. Keras is a Python library. I like to think of it as a layer of, it is a layer of abstraction on top of other tools which are a little more data science-y. Those tools could be Microsoft's TNTK, Theano, which don't use, it's in containment, or TensorFlow. TensorFlow 2.0 is out, which some of you are probably aware of. It's doing a lot of the kind of things Keras does, but I haven't really looked at it yet. It's on my list of things to do. But Keras is kind of like a domain-specific language for building neural networks. So instead of focusing on the math, you can focus on, hey, I want a layer, and I want it to be this big, and I want it to be of this type. So here is some code. Hopefully that's readable in the back. I can't make it bigger because it's a slide. But here I'm saying modeled equals sequential. And then I start adding layers to my model. Sequential means the first layer, then the next layer, then the next layer, then the next layer. So it's just saying I've got a bunch of layers in sequence. That's all it means. There are other ways of types of models you can build if you want models that feed back on themselves. There's different types of ways of doing that. Model.add, we add a convolutional layer here. Convolution 2D. So we got a two-dimensional convolutional layer, meaning, hey, I'm looking at pictures. Could be other two-dimensional data, but probably pictures. In that two-dimensional convolutional layer, I have 48 kernels or filters, 48 unique shapes I want to find in that image. Those kernels should be 3 pixels by 3 pixels. And the activation function is ReLU. And my input shape is 24 pixels by 24 pixels by 1 pixel deep. The 1 pixel deep is for red, green, blue in an image, because you've got color depth. In our case, I'm doing black and white, so I just have one. And then once I've gone through that convolutional layer, I want to pool it 2 by 2. And then I've got a convolutional layer of 24 filters, 3 by 3, ReLU again. And then another pooling, flattening. And then I got a dense layer here, 128 neurons. And then at the very end, I've got this layer with 16 neurons and an activation of softmax. Softmax says these all 16 of these need to add up to 0 for their output. So you can express it as a percentage. I have 16 because there are 16 runes in the Younger Futhark. So I'll get a number for each rune, which is reflecting how likely it is it's that particular one. And they all add up to 100%. Another thing here worth noting is that there's a conv2D that suggests that you might be able to do convolutions on one-dimensional data or three-dimensional data. Yes, you can. The key thing here is you're doing that scanning across the thing, looking for patterns. And so if you're doing one-dimensional convolutions, you might have, like, say, a sound file, sound data, which shows the amplitude of a wave at any particular point in time. And then your kernels would only be one-dimensional, so you might be three data points wide. And so you can do one-dimensional. You could do three-dimensional. I don't know if Keras supports three-dimensional. I imagine at some point it gets too wieldy and it won't work. Like if you try to do 7 dimensions, A, that's hard to think about. But B, I think the number of connections would just get too much and you wouldn't be able to compute it all. But you can do multi-dimensional stuff and single-dimensional stuff. Once I have specified what my model looks like, my network looks like, I tell it to compile it, give it an error function, give it an optimizer, and say, hey, what metrics do you want me to measure? And then I just call model.fit. Pass in my train data my train labels, so X train and Y train. X is all my inputs. It's the images. It's an array of two-dimensional, it's a NumPy array, actually, of two-dimensional images. Y-train is a bunch of encoded labels. It's actually using one hot encoding, but I'm not going to get into that because I'm already running a little short on time. And the batch size is 32, 20 epochs, verbosa 1. Tell me everything you do. Let's do a demo, or a tema, as you would write that in runes. Okay. The code for all this is on GitHub, and I'll have a link at the end. So if you want to play with it, you're welcome to. I've got, here I'm using conda. So I'm going to do conda activate Viking. Because I created a profile called Viking, and I just think it sounds cool to tell conda to activate the Vikings. So there we go. Actually, it was already set. But I've got 2 apps here. I've got a buildModel.py, which builds my model. And I've got an app.py, which creates a Flask application to expose it as a RESTful service. Well, RESTful as a web-based service might be a better way to put it. So if I run my Python build model, you see it's loaded a bunch of runes as JSON files off the hard drive that I spent 4 hours of my life creating. And it's going through the entire data set 20 times. And so it just finished, and I've got, this is the accuracy, 0.91566, which is pretty good, honestly, for roughly 400 runes that I wrote by hand. I will admit that this model is overfit to my handwriting. And then we got an error of 0.36, which is okay. But let's go ahead and use this model. Run app.py. I'll go to my browser here. Let me refresh this. Okay. So to create runes, I would just pick a rune at random and I'd draw it. This is what I spent 4 hours doing one day. Then I hit save. It would give me another rune to draw. I thought this would be a good way to spend an afternoon. I hope you all are enjoying this. But if I go out and look in at my code here and look in this data, you can see the git says that's now dirty because I've created runes there. So it just saves them off. If you look at one, it's just JSON data. I've got the name of the rune, and I've got an array of arrays showing that rune. All it's doing. And then I got a bunch of Python code that loads that up and turns it into NumPy arrays so that we can use it with Keras. By the way, who all pronounces it NumPy? Who pronounces it NumPy? Thank you. NumPy is way funner. I like to call it NumPy because I think it's funny. I think it was intended to be NumPy, but I don't care. Don't tell me how to live my life. So then what it's doing, when I built the model, it read all those runes in. So now I can just pick a rune. Let's do something really easy. It's really good at detecting ESA. Hey! Should I do a different one? Anyone have one they'd like to see me do? Okay, I will do that, but I'm going to save that for last. Let's do Bjork. Yeah, the thing it has the most problems with, honestly, is... that's Haggle. Let's try Bjork again. It usually confuses Bjork and Wreath. There, did that. Yay! And if we do Wreath here... Now I got it this time, so... I don't know what it's doing. It's magic, right? But you can see how it might confuse that. And I gave it like 300, I gave it 400 samples to work with, so this is not a lot of data. And in fact, when I drew the runes, I didn't draw any on the side, which is the key thing that makes convolutional neural networks different. And so if I draw an ESA over here and hit detect, oh wow, I got it right this time. It almost never gets that right. Let's draw one over here. Yeah, it gets it wrong. It won't do that effectively either. Let's do an ESA this way. Yeah. No. I didn't give it a good variety of data, partly because I wanted a model that built fast, partly because I didn't want to spend 4 more days entering runes by hand. And I primarily just needed a demo for this talk. But if you were doing something real, you'd want a better test of data. You could take this data and massage it and say, okay, take all these images and move them a little bit, make copies of them and move them to the left or move them to the right, rotate them a little bit to get more data. It also looks, when you see here, it looks like this is very granular, right? But I actually concentrate this down to 24 pixel by 24 pixel image. And so when I hit detect here, you can see it come by, I spit out the numbers I get. And so we just got, that's all the data we're using to build this. And so if we say do Bjork, you can see there it is, cast in bits. So, can I get a volunteer from the audience? Someone want to try it out? You want to try it out? We don't have to have a volunteer. if anyone wants to give it, come on up. Yeah. It actually works fairly well, even on other people's handwriting. But honestly, in a 24 pixel by 24 pixel thing, how much handwriting variation is there really? It's just push and click.
I'm like kind of new to Max. All right.
Yay! So one of the things that someone asked me to do one time was do a smiley face. Let's see what it does with a smiley face. So I'm going to do a smiley face. And I think he should be a happy Viking. So let's give him a helmet. You know, he looks more like he's got a tinfoil hat on, doesn't he? And apparently that's Ur. Yeah. But it looks funny here. And then last but certainly not least, we're going to do the Bluetooth logo. And, you know, this thing can only answer, well, I boogered that up. It can only detect things it knows about. So, like, if you hand it a smiley face, it's going to make a guess. And so it will make a guess for the Bluetooth logo as well. In this case, it guessed Bjork, which is a reasonable guess, right? I mean, it is one of the pieces of the rune. So, all this code is out on GitHub. You guys can play with it. The runes are out there as well, so you can build these models. I did discover that you can't run the application until you build the model because it tries to pull up the model as part of the application running. So if you wanted to run the application, create a bunch of runes, and then build a model, if that doesn't work anymore. But fortunately, there's 400 runes out there for you to play with. I don't have enough time to go over the code here, so I'm just going to go ahead and plow on for 3 more minutes. And so here's the resources I used to put together this talk. You can go out. This slide is also in the GitHub repository, so you're welcome to take a picture of it. But you can also get a PDF of this. I used a Keras, Microsoft CNTK, and TensorFlow there, learning how those work, and Theano. I used Flask as the web server. So if you're not familiar with Flask, this is PyOhio, so probably everyone knows Flask. But if you're not, it reminds me of Sinatra, actually. I used Vanilla.js for all my JavaScript, which is the best framework of all the JavaScript frameworks, in my opinion, after Dejour.js, which just tells you what the date is. The information about the Younger Futhark can be found here, and the Neural Network Zoo has a sort of a taxonomy of different neural network structures that you can build. And then on the right here, I have several talks blog posts and stuff and tutorials that I worked through to learn how a lot of this stuff worked. And so check those out. This CS231N was actually part of a computer science class on neural networks. And so that was particularly useful. And if you want to do any of this code, you can go to github.com/guyroyce/deep-learning-like-a-viking. And this is the magic URL that gets you all the things I just talked about. The code's out there. The slides are out there. The abstract for the talk's out there. It's all out there. So check that out. I'll pause momentarily for people to take photos. These are a bunch of pictures I stole off the internet for my slides. And that's pretty much all I got. I'm Guy Royce. I could take one question. I got like 1 minute. If there's any questions. Sure. Is there a reason I chose not to use what type of data? I didn't think about it until I had the talk done. That's really all there is. I could do that, and that's not a bad plan. It would be a good thing to add to the talk, but I just haven't yet. So the reason is just time. So nice question. Thank you. And thanks a lot. I work for Script Drop, by the way. Check us out.